This morning, we, after being in the Old Testament for our Bible 101 sermon series, we've been in Genesis, we've been in Exodus, we've been in Psalm 23, and last week we looked at Isaiah 53, what I believe to be the best, if you will, chapter on prophecy in the Bible. Now, for the second half of our sermon series for these next 5 weeks, we will look now at the New Testament as we continue the story of Scripture. And of course, the New Testament brings with it the story, the best story, that of Jesus. And this morning, we're going to be looking at John 3:16, which is the most famous verse in the Bible. Billy Graham famously said that his whole life, all he was really trying to do, and all those crusades he did, speaking and preaching to millions of people, every sermon, I was just trying to do my best to preach John 3:16, and I never did it as good as I thought I should. That's what he said. He had one sermon. It was this sermon, John 3:16. And it is indeed a high point of Scripture, because it so succinctly lays out in a short one verse the gospel and how deep it is and how beautiful it is. I think we all know this verse, and for some of you, maybe this morning you'll say, oh, this is why this is the verse at all the football games. Because if you ever watch NFL football, you know what I'm talking about. Some of you don't know what I'm talking about. That's totally fine. But for years and years, NFL football games, you'd see John 3:16, or you'd see guys underneath their eyes and say John 3:16, because this is the most famous verse. And here it is. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For some of us, this was the very first verse we learned as children. For many of us, this is the verse we can easily say from memory. Now, when we go through it, it has such explosive, amazing power. Again, in such a small space. Think about when you go on, on an official picnic, and you take like a real picnic basket. It's a good thing, it's always fun, right? And you're going by the river, and you got your blanket, and right, you go in the picnic basket, and you pull out the cheese crackers, and you pull out the best deli sandwiches, and you pull out some nice fruit, and then for dessert, it's cheesecake. Then, of course, what else we got in here? Depending on your taste, maybe it's sparkling apple cider or champagne or whatever it might be. And you unpack the beautiful picnic basket. There is a lot to unpack in John 3:16. For who? For God. God did what? He loved. Who did he love? The Israelites? Those in the Middle East, men, people under the age of 20? No. For God so loved the entire world. There are people, for some of us in this room, you could think, there's that group of people I struggle to love. There's that group of people, when I think about them, I go, ugh. Not so with God. For God so loved the world. Everyone in the world. And because he loved everyone in the world, what happened? It moved him to action. He gave. And as I mentioned with the kids, what did he give? His most precious thing. He gave his only begotten son. Let's go into the picnic basket and unpack that phrase a little bit. What does that mean? God's only begotten son. First, that language comes from Genesis 22, where we read this. Going back now to the first book of the Bible, this phrase is echoed here in John 3:16. Then God said to Abraham, take your son, your only begotten son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Moriah would later be known as Jerusalem. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you. So God says to Abraham, take Isaac, the one on whom I told you the promises hinge, through whom the Messiah is going to come, and I want you to sacrifice him. I had an English professor in college, and he said, I would be a Christian today except for this story in the Old Testament. He hated this story. How could God ask Abraham to do this thing? I remember I wrote my final paper in that class on this story, trying to convince my professor to become a Christian, because it was a test. He didn't. There was no sacrifice until God asked Jesus, his only begotten son, whom he loves, and he sacrificed him for all of us. Now, the verse, two verses before this verse, John 3:14 and 15, let's get a little context. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, if you don't know that story, that's going to sound like a really weird sentence. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man, that is Jesus, must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. In the Old Testament, in the book of Numbers, the great Exodus, Moses is leading his people out of slavery, out of the oppression under the Pharaoh. And what happens on their 40-year journey to the Promised Land? What do the people do a lot? Complain, rebel, complain. Moses, let's just go back to Egypt. What have you done? You brought us out into this desert to die? So that's happening all the time. And on one such occasion, when the people rebelled, in addition to complaining, there were snakes, and they were biting the people. And some of them were dying. And so Moses, as the intercessor, went to God and said, help. And God said, make a bronze snake and put it on top of a pole and lift it up and tell the people, if you look at this snake after you get bit, you'll be healed. Some of you are looking at me like, is that really the story? That's the story. It's there. I think it's Numbers chapter 21. So, the people, as they got bit by snakes, as an act of faith, they looked at this bronze snake that Moses lifted up, and they were healed. The only reason they were healed is, again, by faith. There was no physical medication or anything. It was God said, do this. And so in the same way that Moses lifted up that snake and the people looked upon the bronze snake for healing, so this verse is saying Jesus will be lifted up, not on a pole, but on a cross. And when you look on the cross, you will be what? Healed. That's the idea. A lot more permanently with Jesus on the cross versus a silly little snake bite. The verse right after John 3:16 obviously is John 3:17. For God did not send his son into the world to what? Condemn the world, but to save the world through him. God did not send Jesus. You guys know that sandwich sign? This is kind of like the sandwich sign at Turn or Burn. You know, preachers on the corner, and they have that sandwich sign that says Turn or Burn. You know? God didn't send Jesus with a sandwich sign that says, you're all going to burn. Not even turn and burn, just you're all going to burn. Condemn. right? This is not why God sent Jesus. The Greeks and the Romans, they had many pantheon of gods. One of the defining features of Greek and Roman mythological gods was their capriciousness. That is, their sometimes being not so kind to human beings. But when the only real God shows up, he loves. He's not here to condemn. Why are you here, Jesus? God sent me. Save all of you. For God so loved everybody that he gave his only begotten Son. Now, second thing to note about Jesus as the Son of God. People get confused. What does that mean? What does it mean that Jesus is God's Son? Does that mean that Jesus is a created being? This is not what it means. In fact, there was a man named Arius who was a great pastor in Egypt. This is now the year 300. So the church has been around 300 years. In the first 300 years of the church, they're getting persecuted, they're getting killed. But around 312 AD, finally, the church stopped being persecuted. And in fact, because of the Emperor Constantine, Christianity becomes the state religion of the Roman Empire. And it's in that century, the 300s, where Christians, instead of being killed and persecuted, start thinking and reflecting deeply on their faith. Because now they're not being killed. In that context, Arius was a pastor who said this phrase: there was a time when the Son of God was not. There was a time when the Son of God was not. Meaning, Jesus, according to Arius, was a created being. According to Arius, God and Jesus then are not the same thing. Jesus is amazing and wonderful, but God created him as like the first great, wonderful thing before creating the world. The entire church gathered at a place called Nicaea, which is in Turkey, in the year 325. And to this day, in this church, you'll note every now and again, we will say out loud the Nicene Creed. And they came together in that conference to say, Arius is mistaken on this. Jesus, as the Son of God, is eternal. He has always been, just like John 1:1, right? Just two chapters before our verse today. The opening lines of the Gospel of John. In the beginning was the Logos in Greek. That is the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jesus is the eternal Son of God. There never was a time when the Son of God was not. Arius was mistaken. And the church has collectively affirmed this down through the centuries. So God loves the world. He gives Jesus. And whoever believes should not perish, but have eternal life. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus tells a terrifying story about the sheep and the goats. And the goats are those who don't believe. And they go away to eternal torment. Eternal torment. That is hell. There was a book that came out 10 years ago. It caused a great scandal in the evangelical community. That book was called Love Wins by Rob Bell. And in that book, Rob Bell says, when Jesus says in Matthew, the sheep and the goats and the goats who don't believe in him go away to eternal torment, Rob Bell says, well, that just means a long time of pruning, and that will end, and they'll get in. They'll get in. Which, of course, is not the meaning of eternal torment. Otherwise, you would not use the word eternal when you meant a good long time. Naturally, people pointed this out because, in essence, well, I mean, you can understand. Who of us wants to see anybody go to hell for eternity? Well, none of us want that for our family or our friends. There's been times in my life where I run across a verse about hell. You know, my human reaction is, I'm just going to rip this page out and throw it over there. Well, that's not going to do any good because God is the one who is in charge of this here universe. And it's definitely not me. And God, in his goodness, in his judgment as judge of this universe, knows what he's doing. And so the flip side of Matthew, in other words, of the goats who don't believe going to eternal torment, is John 3:16. And I tried to point this out to Rob, because it's the exact same word here, aneon, in Greek, eternal. In other words, the promise here in John 3:16 is not that we should not perish, but have a good amount of time with Jesus. In other words, a non-eternal time, like whatever it is, 23,000 years, and then that's it. The point is that if you believe in the Son, you get eternal life. That's a lot longer than 23,000 years. It's really, really good news. John 3:16 is too much. It is God saying, this is how much I love you. I love you enough to give you myself. And I will sacrifice myself because I want to be with you. There's a great story called Babette's Feast. And it's the story about a French cook who goes to Denmark. And she cooks for 30 years for this family. And this family, to simplify, are basically like Amish. They're very simple. They don't like anything extravagant. It has to be very simple. Babette wins the lottery. $1 million. And so the family assumes, Babette, thank you for being our cook for 30 years. You've won the lottery. God bless. Whatever you're going to do with that $1 million, we're pretty sure you're not going to hang out with us. Instead, Babette orders from France all kinds of the best food, new furniture, like a kitchen table and the best candlelight, and spends all of her $1 million on one meal for this family. The family, of course, is shocked when they sit down to the most extravagant meal of their life. And the point of the whole film is this, that Babette's extravagant love is an illustration of God's extravagant love for us that we see in John 3:16. God goes to extraordinary lengths to show us his love by giving us his only Son. I close with this story, this true story. 20 years ago, a young boy, said to his dad, Dad, at school, there's going to be a race. And I'd like to run in the race. And his dad said, that's fine, go ahead. And the son said to his dad, Dad, you know what would be really cool? If you ran the race with me. And the dad said, I've never run a race. But okay, I love you, you're my son. So the father and the son, they ran in the race together. And the son said to the dad afterwards, Dad, that was like the best day of my life. I have heard that there's going to be a marathon slightly longer than the whatever 5-mile run that they just did. Dad, there's going to be a marathon. And you know what would be great? If you ran with me in the marathon. And naturally the dad said, I've never done that either. But I love you. So the father and the son, they ran the marathon together. And the son said afterwards, Dad, that was great. That was the best day of my life. But I've heard about this other thing called a triathlon, where there's swimming, and there's bicycling, and a marathon. And the dad said, I don't even know how to swim. But the father learned how to swim. And the father and the son, they did the triathlon together. The swimming and the bicycling and the marathon. And this is the video of when they did that together.
To a thousand tongues, but there is one that sounds above them all. The Father's song, the Father's love, you sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heaven's perfect melody, the Creator's symphony. You are singing over me, the Father's song. Heaven's perfect mystery, the King of Love has sent for me. Singing over me. sung it over me and for eternity. It's written on my heart. It's written on my heart. You sing it over me.
This is how God loves you. This is how God loves you. This is how God loves you. Do you get it? God loves you that much. Do you get it? God created a universe. He sent prophets. And then finally he sent his son, and he gave him for you. He sacrificed him on your behalf. What do we have to do? All we got to do is sit like that son and believe and let God do the work. The cross is the work. We don't do the work. We believe that the cross and Christ's sacrifice does all the work, and that God loves us like that father loves his son. Like Babette loved that family and spent $1 million on a feast. It's extravagant. It's ridiculous. And that's the kind of God that we have. And every day we go through our lives and we think, I don't know. Where's my life going? Am I happy in this life? Do you realize how much God loves you? We're going to go through John 3:16 one more time. I'm going to say the verse. The only thing you're going to say is your full name, silently. We're Presbyterians, so don't expect you to shout. But you see, there's three places here where you're going to insert your name. And you're going to think to yourself, God loves me like that father loves his son. Okay? You're just going to whisper your name in those three spots. For God so loved, you better be whispering. You're going to start at the top. All you're doing is saying your name, first and last name. Talk about you. For God so loved that he gave his one and only son, that if believe in him shall not perish, have eternal life. When I first saw this video with the Father and the Son, the triathlon, the year was 2002. Bawled my eyes out just like all of you did. And I said to myself, that is the best sermon illustration in the universe. And I've been using it ever since. And every time I watch it, 20 years later, I still cry. Because what a perfect picture of how God loves us. When you think of God's love for you, I hope you think of this story. True story. In the name of that father and the son, Team Hoyt. H-O-Y-T. Let's pray.